want to say, considering the things that the Democrats have been saying, like about guys like you and I and the things that we're talking and writing about, well, when they come for us and they put us in the same cell, I want the top bunk.
Frank, that is not going to happen. I'm not going down that way. I'm telling you that right now. So,
It is amazing, though, that we are actually, and I can tell you this and to all your audience, conservative commentators and even centrist commentators are all having that type of conversation. The criminalization of any speech that is not pro-left-wing, pro-Democrat is becoming a reality. You know, it's not something I think any of us really believed would happen in America, but certainly is happening now. When you listen to what Nancy Pelosi is saying, when you listen to the new Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer, what he's saying about conservatives, mm-hmm. The latest of coming from Schumer is that perhaps airlines should not allow people who took place in demonstrations in Washington to fly,
yeah.
to travel.
Yeah.
So we are looking at something we never thought we'd see in the United States.
Well, you know, but we have no one to blame but ourselves. If we sit back passively and allow this to happen, allow this started, Frank, under the Obama administration. And I wrote a piece last night. I couldn't sleep. I'm hearing this stuff and I just couldn't sleep. So I wrote a piece last night and it says elections have consequences and so do actions. And the bottom line is for me that, Barack Obama said elections have consequences, and he said that so cavalierly to John McCain. John, elections have consequences. He was very personal about that. So the actions were and are that they did everything they could to transform America into what? Into a Lenskyism, into socialism. And Barack Obama was never called out on it because he's half black and people wanted to tip around it. See, this is where Republicans get themselves in trouble and have gotten themselves in trouble. And they go, we have to form a new party. And we have to form, and I've never said this before, I never really put a lot of thought into it, but I'm very convinced at this point that we're going to have to form a new party. Just bear me out on this, Frank, I'm going to tell you about my article in a minute. We're going to have to form a new party because the Republican Party is totally sold off. We're going to have to form a new party, fund a new party. The only person that I can think that has the money and the capital to pull that off is Donald Trump. See, Donald Trump can pull together a real third party and pull Republicans from the so-called Republican Party into this new party because he has the money. See, there are only two parties in the country for a reason, the Democrat-Republican Party. They have a headquarters, both of them in D.C. Both of them had pipe bombs left out at their facilities, their buildings, incidentally. Before last Wednesday. So we have to have a new party because these Republicans refuse to do the will of conservative people in America. They refuse to do the will, and they keep confusing racism because they refuse to, America refuses to address its race issue. They try to, it's not about it. Everything in this country centers about race. This country was built on the race issue, and people try to ignore that. As far as I'm concerned, the American Revolution was fought over the slavery issue, but that's digressing here. The reality is we need people in government who are going to go and represent conservative values, traditional values, the things that made this country great. Everything else, every other form of government has failed in this world, except for this thing we call American democracy, which is really a republic.
Well, that's absolutely true. And let's understand what this fight is all about. This isn't just Democrats against Republicans, even liberals against conservatives. What this fight is all about is whether the concept of individual rights will survive in the United States when it's failed so many times throughout the world. Look, let's be blunt. there is a significant portion of the American population, particularly those educated in the past 20 or 30 years, who have been brought up to believe that individualism, that the Bill of Rights, is an impediment to achieving their goals. You have a group of people who believe they're smarter and better than everyone else, and that your rights are just standing in the way of some genius from Harvard or Yale restructuring your life, restructuring your government, restructuring your society in the way that benefits not you, not the majority, but them, that elite that have had far too much power in this country, and particularly among the major universities and the things that they are teaching our young. That's a real crisis. Again, this is not politics as normal. This is the very survival of individual freedom.
And, you know, I don't think that that Democrat or that Republicans took this very, very seriously. You know, how can you allow corrupt voting machines to do a vote in Georgia when you know the damn voting machines are contaminated? You know, the votes are going to be manipulated. You know, we have. And you and I haven't talked since the riots or the march. I'm not going to call it a riot. I'm not going to call it a mob. Since the march in D.C. But this is what I have to say about that, Frank, right off the top. And that is the people who those young people in the Capitol who were vandalizing the Capitol and really vandalizing to what extent? They look like Antifa. They walk like Antifa. They talk like Antifa and Black Lives Matter. And I think that's who they were. Now, there was an interesting clip that I saw with General McInerney, and I hadn't really, you really don't see it a lot, but you can find it. And it's really interesting. These guys, they're big, they're husky. You can tell they're fit. They're dressed differently than the Antifa people. They're dressed differently than the protesters. You know, they have on military style gear, and they're pushing through the crowd, and they're saying, "We're not with Antifa." And so General McInerney said they were the special forces guys, and they went in and got Pelosi's computer, and that's why she's going ballistic about impeaching Trump.
Well, I think there's an even, believe it or not, an even larger issue. It was bad enough when we talk about these demonstrations, but isn't it even a larger issue that the media refuses to talk at all about the fact that there was no relation about anything that Trump said that could have led to this riot? You know, if you go back to 1969, there was a case of Brandenburg v. Ohio.
Right.
And it was a terrible case in and of itself. There was a radical extremist, I believe it was the Ku Klux Klan, and he made some pretty horrible statements. And the state tried to basically tell him that he couldn't say what he was saying, that they wouldn't let him go forward. And the court ruled that you can't basically take away someone's First Amendment rights unless they are immediately saying with specific detail, you know, let's do this act of violence right now. Now, clearly the standard, when applied to whatever Donald Trump or Rudy Giuliani stated, means that they have no liability, there's nothing they did. And in fact, on a common sense basis, there's nothing that either Donald Trump or Rudy Giuliani said that encouraged violence. So the acts of Nancy Pelosi and the others and the media that support them, let's impeach Donald Trump, let's you know, take away their Twitter accounts and all that, clearly that goes against the court decision, and it clearly goes against the First Amendment.
Right.
But the battle lines are really clearly drawn. There is a group that doesn't want you, the great unwashed American public, to have First Amendment rights because they, the elite, they know best, they think, and they don't think that they don't want people like you or I or the general public intervening in their unified rule of the country. It's getting worse and worse.
Well, you know, remember when Obamacare was being decided, when Obamacare was being talked about, Pelosi was very clear. She said, "We know what's best for you." She said, we know what's best for you. She said, she wanted to say, you don't know what you need, but she said, we know what's best for you. And I thought about that and I was like, but nobody in the mainstream media ever talks about that statement she made. You and I remember it because how it affected us, right?
Have a great show.
But most people, they don't even get it. That this chick said, well, we know what's best for you. We're going to give you this health care because we're going to take care of your health care until you would. But at the same time, they exempted themselves. So if the health care is so great, they should have been the first ones taking it. If the vaccine is so wonderful, how come they didn't line up the 1,000 people in the Capitol, the 435 representatives and 100 senators, and pop them in the arm? That would have been a mass inoculation right there, right? You know, you light everybody up, you got the joint session, boom, 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 just hit everybody, you know, with the vaccine. But they didn't do it.
In fact, I wouldn't say humorous, but one of the more interesting aspects of that, of course, in some states like New York, they claim under some kind of color of being pro-black or something. Mm-hmm. Well, we should inoculate the minority population first. I think what the elites are actually saying, let's give it to those folks, and then if they don't all die of cancer within the first couple of weeks, hey, then we'll give it to the rest of them.
Well, you know, the Tuskegee experiment is on my mind.
Indeed.
The remnants of that was far-reaching, and it was far more reaching than Tuskegee. My grandfather, who was in Missouri, was part of that that experiment. So it's interesting. What's interesting to me is today the medical community is still not trusted in the Black American community. They're still not trusted. I don't trust doctors. I have an inherent distrust of doctors because of my family's history and because of my dealings with doctors. You know, I had a doctor who refused to give me pain medication because he thought I would become addicted. I'm a naval officer. I've never been arrested for drugs. I have no history of drug use. In fact, I've rejected painkillers in the past. And this little asshole decided he was not going to give me drugs because blacks have a higher propensity. Man, I wanted to fuck it. I wanted to strangle this some bitch. Okay. I'm serious, man. But you know, it goes back to another point of mine, Frank. We need black professionals dealing with black professionals. I had a doctor. There was a dentist in my neighborhood, white dentist from Kentucky. And this son of a bitch, black people's teeth were so perfect and so clean that he would drill from your molars all the way up to your eye teeth. And he put in a layer of fillings when you didn't need fillings. You hear me? And he didn't give you the painkiller you needed. And this woman who worked for him, this white woman who worked for him, told me that. She said she couldn't take it anymore, how he was basically just brutalizing. Like, I went for a teeth cleaning, Frank, and my teeth are great. I mean, when I was younger, they were pearly white, perfectly shaped, you know, perfect mouth of teeth. And this guy gave me an abscess on my front tooth, a teeth cleaning. He pressed my tooth so hard that it gave me an abscess. And now, I mean, you know, I brushed my teeth with baking soda in those days. I mean, so you ask yourself, how do people in the medical profession have these racist tendencies? And you know what really pisses me off more than anything else is how dumb black people are. Black Americans, and I'll say this again, and I say this without reservation or equivocation. Black Americans are the stupidest group of people in the goddamn world. Excuse my language. Stupid. You know, we refuse to, you know, we need doctors, we need lawyers, we need those professionals. And we ran around talking about some damn artists and feeling good and shaking our booty and stuff like that instead of an education. You know, since the civil rights movement, blacks with a degree or blacks with an education are considered Uncle Toms. Blacks who speak correct, Uncle Toms. And, you know, you look at Donald Trump. And Donald Trump has done more for all Americans, and especially black Americans, than any damn president in my lifetime. He's done more for the American people. He stopped the caravans of migrants coming to our borders that we take care of. Black people are affected more by that than any other group. We always are affected by as the saying goes, when America gets the flu, when America sneezes, black folks have COVID-19. That's a new saying. But
and it goes back to the other topic we're talking about. What you're saying about Donald Trump and black America is absolutely correct. But yet the narrative in the media is that somehow Donald Trump is racist, but Democrats who, you know, basically were for slavery, for segregation, were the founding fathers for the Ku Klux Klan. Somehow it's Democrats that are the party that are pro-black, and right. Somehow Republicans, it's the party that's portrayed as being anti-black.
What did I tell you about stupidity? If I'm sure if you asked the average black, if you went into a black community today and you did a test and you said, was Abraham Lincoln a Democrat or Republican? And you get answers like this. Of course he's a Democrat. Of course he was a Democrat. Are you stupid?
And as you and I have discussed on numerous occasions, some of the popular left-wing concepts, like, for example, gun control, all had their origins in the racism of the Democratic Party.
Well, let me take this a step further for you, Frank, because you won't believe this. I know you won't believe this. When we were fighting for concealed carry here in the state of Illinois, the rest of the state supported gun concealed carry. The guy who blocked it was Richard Daley, the mayor of Chicago. The mayor of Chicago and the mayors of Chicago, all Democrats, took guns out of the hands of law-abiding black citizens, and they're trying to do it again because we don't want to incarcerate black criminals. We have too many black men in the criminal justice. They belong in the criminal justice system if they committed a crime. I mean, we have a higher incidence.
The stunning stupidity of gun control is this. If you have a guy or a gal, I suppose, who's going to rob, rape, or kill, and are they going to say, oh, goodness golly me, I better not use a gun for that because, hey, I could get in trouble. On the other hand, the person who is honestly trying to protect their home, particularly if you live in a difficult, crime-ridden neighborhood, is there to protect themselves from those criminals. So why are you going to take guns out of the hands of honest people, of law-abiding people, while doing absolutely nothing of any effectiveness to take guns out of the hands of criminals?
Because it keeps black folks focused on the nonsense. It keeps black folks from focusing on pursuing the American dream. And the thing that President Trump offered for the first time in a long time was the ability for all people to pursue the American dream without, you know, it's this, you know, we had this socialist thing going on in the black community that I peeped a long time ago. And it's really interesting in that, how can I say this? When I look at the civil rights movement, I look at the one way mindset. I've never thought like a lot of these people in the civil rights movement. My thing is, and I think most people, and especially blacks, their thing is leave me alone and let me pursue the American dream the way that I want to pursue the American dream. Your American dream and my American dream are two different things. And that's okay.
Well, interesting you say that in that way, because when the liberals really started claiming that they were helping black folk, it seems at that point that black folk stopped progressing up the socioeconomic pay scale. If you look at what happened in the northern cities, for example, if you look in the Old South, as bad as it was with segregation, black communities had many professionals taking
yep.
care of business.
Yep.
When the migration north began and when the liberals started intervening in the whole societal thing,
mm-hmm.
it seems that the percentage of black professionals actually went down,
it did.
Not up.
It did.
And that is really an example of everything that you and I are talking about at this point.
But let me tell you what supplanted black professionals. Asian Indians. So you have all these Asian Indians who are in the medical field and in the medical community. They have zero bedside manner. They bring with them a racism that is inbred in their culture. They call us dark-skinned people like me the untouchables. We are the untouchable class. And if you deal with these people, that's the way they treat you. I hear black people complain all the time about these Indian doctors. And if you go over to the University of Chicago, where I go, there's nothing but Indian damn doctors. There are hardly any white people, man. Just Indians every damn where. And I'm going, these people have invaded a profession. And white Americans, black Americans, we've allowed them to do this. Cut off. You see, Trump did a smart thing in ending chain immigration. The guy who was responsible for chain immigration and the degradation of black advancement in America was Ted Kennedy and the Immigration Act of 1965, which he sponsored.
Yeah, one of the interesting additional aspects to all that, of course, is the elitism of the Democrat left. And of course, although the popular portrayal is that somehow rich company owners are the guys who are the Republicans, in reality, they are the Democrat supporters. So you talk about a young guy, it doesn't matter the color of their skin, who graduates from college in the United States, maybe with a degree in computer science, tries to get a job at a decent wage, and finds out that that job was taken by an immigrant who's willing to work for about a third of the pay he was going to get. But that means the elites maintain their elite status. They don't have to pay a lot of money. And, of course, their politicians in Washington back them up with open immigration concepts. So it really is an attack not just on black Americans, I think, but on all working class Americans.
It is, but people don't see it that way, Frank. Like, see, nobody wants to call me. You will never hear anyone call me a racist. And you know why? Because I have the facts. And the facts are, I told Don, God, how come I can never remember his name? He was Secretary of Commerce. Don, shoot, I can't come up with Don's first name. But anyway, he was Bush's first Secretary of Commerce. And I told him that he needed to focus on H-1B visas. See, this is the thing that Charles Butler does. You know, I'm so far ahead of the power curve. When people go, well, you know, he said to me, this is the Secretary of Commerce. He said to me, Don Evans, that's his name. Don said to me, well, what are H-1B visas? This is the Secretary of Commerce. This is in 2009.
Oh, that's just great.
So he said, Charles, would you call me and tell me what they are? And I did. I called him and you know, explained to him what they were and why they were bad for Americans. Well, again, Bush, Cheney, and the other power elites were in bed with whom? The high tech companies, the globalists. I remember
the same high tech companies, by the way, that today are censoring out Donald Trump's tweets and censoring out people like you and I.
Yeah, but see, Frank, that's okay with them because they want us censored. The Democrat leadership in this country. That's why I say we need another party. So whether it's Pence or whomever, these are all people who are bought and paid for by the high-tech companies, the corporations. Look at J.P. Morgan said, oh, okay, we're going to eliminate, we're not going to donate to any campaign. That's what they said. We're not going to donate to any campaign. Okay. So what does that mean?
And by the way, don't eliminate that link between a lot of the, or don't ignore any of that links between companies like Google, Facebook, Twitter, and Hollywood in general, to the people that are really pulling some of the strings behind our backs, and that is the Chinese. If you look at the people who are really trying to get rid of Donald Trump the most vehemently, Adam Schiff, Nancy Pelosi, Dianne Feinstein, and of course Eric Swalwell.
Have you noticed that Feinstein is missing in action? Have you noticed that?
Yeah, lately she certainly has been. All of whom are California Democrats, all of whom have campaign ties to those big tech companies, all of those are trying to woo the Chinese because they see those billion Chinese and they want to sell them popcorn and product and all that sort of thing.
But this is the reality of that, Frank. So when you say that, remember this. The Chinese economy, the Chinese country is a country of peasants. We built, over the last 20 years, we built a 300-person middle class for the Chinese while we decimated the American middle class. We totally destroyed the American middle class.
And all the way back when a lot of this was being discussed, when globalization was first becoming a significant part of the conversation, I looked and wrote at the time that it appears to me that globalization isn't about making a Chinese peasant the equivalent of an American middle classer. It's making the American middle class the equivalent of a Chinese peasant.
No question. Exactly. It's absolute. So this is the thing, the arguments that get me. I don't know about you, but I hear these morons go, well, the American worker has to compete globally. How stupid is that?
Yeah. You're taking a couple of centuries of progress and basically throwing it under the bus.
Wait a minute. How stupid is that? When you leave America, when you go south of the border to Mexico, the scale of economy changes. So $100 in Mexico goes a long way. You could have a decent, a real nice lifestyle in Mexico for $100 a week. You can't live on that in America because of scales of economy. But because Americans don't travel, because Americans are undereducated, they have no idea, no clue. Because in the old days, when I'd go to London, there was £2 to a dollar, £4 to a dollar. So if something cost $20, it cost me in U.S., what, $5, $10? So if something costs, those were scale. When you go to Japan to buy camera equipment, I remember all the guys on the ships used to save their money. They said, we had to save our money because when we go to Japan, that's when we buy our camera equipment. You go to Japan, you buy camera equipment cheap. And why? Because scale of economy, right? So look, I'm going to say one of my YouTube people made a comment, Pete Ortez. He says we could compete with all these international countries if we have a tax and tariff system comparable to them. Absolutely right. Because the Japanese still won't allow American cars into Japan.
Yeah. There's even a more humorous story. If you look at the Japanese are baseball fans just like Americans. But if you try to sell American sports equipment in Japan, you run up against trade barriers that have been insurmountable. Hey, Charles, I just realized I have to run. I look forward to our next conversation.
Hey, man, we could do this for another 4 or 5 hours and still not
express ourselves. And enjoy doing it as well. Yeah. Take care, Charles.
Okay, you too. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Okay, folks, that's Mr. Frank Vernuccio. I'm going to mute that. If you guys want to call in, open up the call-in lines. It's 215-86... What is it? 867-8255. Top Talk, 215 Top Talk. So, feel free to call in and join the conversation. One of the articles, I wrote an article last night and I'm still working on it. And I'm trying to pull it up now. Let's see. Here it is. Let's see here. It's saying that my printers are not available. As I told you guys, I'm having problems with my system, and I think I know why. It's because we're telling the truth out here. We're not pulling any punches. And, one of the things that I want to point out, when they're talking about impeaching President Trump, which is, it may happen, but it's not going anywhere. Dershowitz says once the president's out of office, can't impeach him. Dershowitz is usually right. He usually has his finger on the pulse of the court and the Constitution. And we have something in this country called a Constitution. And it's being usurped by the left. It's being usurped by the left. One of the things that I wrote about, let's see here. if I can pull it up. I'm going to go out here and go to my, it's not a blog, but it's a piece I'm working on. The title of it is Elections Have Consequences. And you guys tell me what you think. You know, you can call in, tell me, or, you know, you can tweet me or, you know, Facebook me. Okay. We're on all those platforms. It says elections have consequences and so do actions. I said, over the past few years, we've heard anecdotes that have had a profound effect in the governing of our country and public discourse. Newly elected President Obama made a statement during a meeting with Republican leadership that has resonated throughout national politics. He was referring to Senator John McCain's comments, and he said, John, elections have consequences. Mr. Obama, in addressing a crowd before his departure from office, offered another anecdote that some Americans used as a battle cry the last 4 years. Resist, resist, resist. When I heard that, I couldn't believe it, that the president was saying resist the incoming administration. What did he mean by that? Like, what did he mean by, we're going to transform America? Really? I mean, that sounds insightful to me. That sounds revolutionary to me. It's not something that I would want and that most Americans would want or vote for, I would think. So as usual, the mainstream media let his comments pass without much criticism, scrutiny, or meaningful analysis as they had his entire presidency. Frankly, the author could not believe that an outgoing president was calling for the American people to conduct sedition and rebellion against the incoming Trump administration. In response to the presidential election of 2020 and all of the irregularities, judicial activism, and unconstitutional shenanigans, both on the state and federal level, the outgoing battle cry should be much the same. In the words of President Obama and Malcolm X, resist, resist, resist by any means necessary. According to numerous polls, the majority of Americans feel the 2020 election was not fair and free. State legislatures responded to post-election results with audits, recounts, and analysis that there were serious incidents of election violations and voter fraud and warranted more investigation by the governing bodies. Charles Butler didn't say this. The state legislators said it. The state legislators did this. Yeah, don't forget to hit the like button, the subscribe button, and the notification button. So you have three buttons to hit on this YouTube before you leave. So you'll know when we're on. We're generally on every day. I go to this point in my note and tell me if you think I'm right or wrong. I said, America has always been a country of divergent views and opinions. The beauty of the American system of governing, because it's a republic, is that all people are able to express those views without consequences. In the past, Congress, the president, and the judiciary have all been faithful to the unique document called the Constitution. Today, our elected officials in Washington, D.C. feel that the words "we the people" are insignificant. Speaker Pelosi promised on national TV that the Congress knows what's best for the people. The mainstream media never challenged her on that 2009 statement in relation to the Affordable Care Act or Obamacare. Mr. Berwin, the father of Obamacare, said in drafting the legislation that Americans are stupid. Nothing could be further from the truth. Okay. Go on to say the American people know exactly what they want and in the direction of the country. What they're not standing idly by and will not let our country deteriorate. It's a mistake that elected officials in Washington think otherwise. As Americans, we debate, we protest, we disagree, and we always reach a fair and equitable solution to our problems. That's why the Republic has existed for over 250 years. I go on to say, I can only remember, there are only two incidents where Americans have come together. One was the attack on Pearl Harbor, December 7th, 1941, and the attack on the World Trade Center, September 11th, 2001. And then after the initial shock of the events, there were differing views on how to respond and proceed. The next 4 years, I say in this article, are going to be tumultuous, spirited, and combative, because some Americans want to transform our country away from the proven principles of a democracy that have made us unique in the world, to those of that have failed other nations. More Americans are asking the question, what kind of country am I leaving for my children? And what can I do to make it a better place for all? The observation today that most of Americans want to be free to pursue life, liberty, and happiness without the interference and judgment of Washington-based politicians with their inside the beltway mentality. America is full of proud people who love their country, its laws, its people, and its laws. So in the upcoming Biden administration, they need to listen to the people. March 6th in Washington, D.C. was not about insurrection, not a coup, but the people expressing their love of our nation. Wow. So what do you guys think of that? Let me know. My guys out there in YouTube, you're listening and you're watching actively. So, let me know what you think. Really. I really want to know. I really want to know ya. But, hey, we're going to take a short break, and I'm going to not play a commercial. I'm going to play a little Miles Davis. I think I'm going to play. No, you know, I'm not going to play Miles. I want to play this by Joe Biden, because Joe was very, very proud of this, right? He was so proud of himself when he said this. Listen.
Secondly, we're in a situation where we have put together, and you guys did it for our administration, the President Obama's administration before this. We have put together, I think, the most extensive and inclusive voter fraud organization in the history of American politics.
Okay. Little Miles there, kind of blue. It does make you kind of blue. Let's see, the mainstream media and the Democrats are one and the same. No question. You can throw Republicans in there too. A lot of rhinos. T. Rob and I have the same problem, Pete. What is that? T. Rob and I have the same problem. Let me go up here and see what that problem is. T. Rob, T. Rob, T. Rob. I don't see T. Rob's comments. Okay. So, sorry about that. Let's see. Pete said we had a constitution and now it's worthless. And all the institutions of government are either corrupt or simply worthless, including those conservative judges that President Trump got approved. Yeah, they're going trying to keep their jobs. They don't want to be impeached. They think that things are bad. No, they're not bad. I think that the country is going to be better off. And we need to deal with that. We need to deal with that. So let's see here. Let's see. Somebody is paging me. You know, we haven't heard from Tom in a while. I wonder where Tom is. Tom from Baltimore. He's usually here somewhere, but he's not today for some reason. Let's see. What I want to play for you is a clip I downloaded. I'm trying to still figure out when and where President Trump incited people to riot. When did he call for people to go out and storm the Capitol and kill and maim and do those things? I'm still trying to find that. Let's see here. I'm going to play this particular clip right here. This is what I think it is. I listened to Trump's speech on the 6th two times this weekend. I just didn't hear the inciting of the crowd. The crowd, when they do a timeline, the crowd was already on its way in the Capitol when the president was speaking. They were already, you know, up the steps and marching in the doors. And like I said, if it walks like a duck, talks like a duck, quacks like a duck, must be Antifa, Black Lives Matter. That's my two cents. But this is what the president had to say. And he's making headway here. Here we go. Let's do this. Let's play it. Here we go. Okay. Nope, not playing it. Okay, so we'll take that off. Maybe we have it here. Let's see. I'll try to play. What I'm trying to play is a clip from the speech on the 6th. I just didn't see where he called for insurrection or a coup. Oh, you know what it is? Let's see here. Here we go. Maybe. Let's see. I can't. There we go.
Demand that Congress do the right thing and only count the electors who have been lawfully slated. I know that everyone here will soon be marching over to the Capitol building to peacefully and patriotically make your voices heard. Today we will see whether Republicans stand strong for integrity of our elections, but whether or not they stand strong for our country. Our country. Our country has been under siege for a long time, far longer than this four-year period. We've set it on a much straighter course, I thought, you know, four more years, I thought it would be easy. We created the greatest economy in history.
Well, yeah. So this is where they say the president incited. People go to the Capitol and destroy the Capitol. I didn't hear it. Did you? I didn't hear it. It's not there. But again, Joseph Goebbels, if you tell a big enough lie long enough and loud enough, people will believe it. And that's why people believe that Donald Trump's a racist. I'm like, give me an example. And they can't. And these people tend to be very adamant. Oh, yeah, Donald Trump's a racist. We have a caller out here. Let's bring the caller in. Hey, caller. How you doing? Caller? Let's see. Hello? Caller? Hello? We have a caller. I'm trying to bring him on or her. Let's see. Hello, hello. Hello. Caller? Nope. Caller is not picking up. Okay. Well, I'll cut it off. Maybe they'll call back. But we tried to pull that caller in. They're calling from Florida. So I'm proud of that. You know, hey, call. Let's see, call and participate and, you know, join in what we're doing here, because what we're trying to do is to educate people. We're trying to educate the masses. I'm not trying to convince anyone to be a Democrat or a Republican. I'm trying to convince people to do the right thing for America, to do the right thing for Americans. That's what I'm interested in. I'm going to bring in the caller now. Hello, caller.
I'm sorry, Charles. That was me earlier that you hung, that I wasn't there.
Okay.
Yeah. Charles, the situation we're in today is because Americans are stupid. If Americans were smart, we would not be in the situation we are today at all. You know, we have these companies censoring, and you hear these people saying, oh, they're private companies. No, we're subsidizing these companies. If they're being subsidized by the taxpayer, so their censoring becomes unconstitutional. If we weren't subsidizing them to the tune of $1 trillion through this 230 amendment to the law,
right,
they wouldn't exist. They wouldn't be able to censor us. But we are subsidizing their censoring, so that makes it unconstitutional.
Hey, Pedro.
I
was looking for my coffee, man, and while you were talking.
Yeah, I see. I'm online. I can see you.
My coffee's gotten cold, man, and but my heart is warm, and it's great to hear your voice and get your input. You're absolutely right, and it's been, you know, we've let this happen to ourselves, but what I heard, you heard me play the clip of Donald Trump and what he said. I just don't hear, and I'm going to play it one more time in case you missed it.
He didn't say anything violent.
Here we go. Let's see. Here we go. I think.
Did Congress do the right thing and only count the man that Congress do the right thing and only count the electors who have been lawfully slated. I know that everyone here will soon be marching over to the Capitol building to peacefully and patriotically make your voices heard. Today we will see whether Republicans stand strong for integrity of our elections, but whether or not they stand strong for our country.
What's wrong with that? Is that insightful? Does that make you want to go out and kill people? Does that make you want to go out and beat people and break things? I don't think so. I don't.
No, Charles, there were a few instigators, 20 instigators.
Yeah, and I think they were. I think for the most part that these people, the one, you know, this is the other thing, Pedro. Let me point out something. And tell me if you think I'm right or wrong. If Antifa had broken into the Capitol like they did in 2017 when they knocked out windows, attacked the police, turned over police cars, set them on fire, they would have taken down and they would have destroyed the artwork that are on the walls. When you walk in the Capitol or when you walk in these government buildings, there's this beautiful artwork everywhere. And as you could see when these people were in the Capitol, beautiful artwork. None of it was pulled off the walls. None of it was spray painted. None of it was destroyed. Excuse me. And no one talks about that. I mean, if you're going to have an insurrection, if you're going to overthrow the government, you'd think that there would be more destruction than there was, wouldn't you?
It was only a few people. It was only a few people walked in there, and the police opened the door for them. This was planned. The day before, the mayor had the National Guard and a bunch of police officers there. All of a sudden, she called back the National Guard and let the police out. They opened the door because it was planned. This reminds me of the Night of Broken Glass in Germany, which is exactly what happened. They allowed a few people to go in and cause a little destruction and blame it on Donald Trump. Just like Germans did when they burned down the Reichstag, what did they do? They blamed it on the Jews. But it was them themselves who did it. And it's the same thing going on here.
Yeah.
It's the same trick. It's going back to the 1938 playbook.
But exactly. And it's all Joseph Goebbels. But where did Goebbels learn propaganda? Joseph
Goebbels.
Yeah, he learned his philosophy and his propaganda from Woodrow Wilson and World War One. That's where he learned the art of propaganda. They said, we treated Jews like America treats blacks. We learned to treat our Jews like America treats blacks. That's how we developed our plan based on America's treatment of Jews. Nobody ever talks about that, but it's out there and it's written. The only guy who really has gone into that has been Dinesh D'Souza. And you saw what happened to Dinesh. Yeah. Man, he spent time in jail. People forget that. He was in jail.
Yeah.
Let's see. Pete said he had to stop. Pete said he had to stop debating his brother in law enforcement. He said it got to the point where you couldn't tell who was the stupid one. Okay. Well, I'm sure it was your brother.
The guy is stupid.
Yeah, man.
He's stupid. The guy, look, you know, he's a black man, and he doesn't understand that they're being replaced, that eventually nobody's going to cater to the black people. Why?
Yep.
All of these illegals are going to be citizens. They're already a majority over the blacks. Who's going to care about what the hell the black people need? Nobody.
They're
not going to be a power at all.
And, you know, and the thing is, you know, you have all of these black babies being aborted. You have these black women who are having babies out of wedlock that nobody wants. And now only, you know, I hate to say this, Pedro, but all of the stories that I see, and I'm sure there are other stories, but most of the stories that I see about child abuse and children being killed are black mothers killing their children or allowing their boyfriends to kill their children, put them in microwave ovens. What kind of shit is that? Who does that kind of sick shit to another human being? It's sick. But then they want to blame it on racism. What does that have to do with racism, child abuse? What does that have to do with racism when you have children out of wedlock that nobody wants, not even the mother?
It started with the welfare system, Charles.
Totally. Neil Bortz. I'm going to have to get him.
It started with the welfare system.
It did.
As soon as they went out and they destroyed the black family, this is what happened. Destroyed the black family.
Totally.
The black family was actually more intact than white families at that point in history.
Yep.
Okay, and all of a sudden, they went house to house telling people to get rid of their husbands so that the government can pay and support them.
Yep.
And this is where we are today.
Where we are today. In fact, a buddy of mine, I'm going to call him and interview him this week. Cause I got to write on that. I got to write about that, Pedro. I got to write about it. Man, I tell you, time goes so fast with this show. I think I'm going to tell Scott I'm going to start doing 2 hours. I got a few sponsors. We're going to pick up the pace, get busy.
Oh, great.
And get back to doing what we normally do. And but I'm getting ready to sign off of Red State. So you guys out there, be good. Come back tomorrow, same time, same place. Okay, so we're off with Red State, and we're still talking on YouTube, so and Facebook and Twitter and all those.
You know what? Woodrow Wilson is the one who started all of this.
Yep.
Right now, we're feeling Woodrow Wilson's seeds.
Well,
he's the one who planted the seeds and has grown to where we are today.
Yeah, well, Woodrow Wilson was not a good man. He was not a good president. He was a racist, an ardent racist. And we had a lot of problems with Woodrow.
Man.
He was definitely an evil man and died a horrible death. But that's one of the reasons we have the 25th Amendment, old Woodrow Wilson. But, you know, this impeachment with Donald Trump is not going anywhere. It's not going anywhere at all.
No.
You know, as Dershowitz said, you know, I heard that dummy out of South Carolina. What's his name? Clyburn. I heard him. Yeah, I heard Clyburn today talk about. How did he say it? Come on. Oh, we're going to hold this over. We're going to hold impeachment over Donald Trump's head the next 100 days. Dude, how can you impeach a president that's gone? I mean, he didn't commit a crime. And they said, well, you don't have to commit a crime to be impeached. So what's the justification for being impeached? I don't get it. Anyway, I guess it's not for me to get.
Impeachment is a political thing. But it's to get him out of office. But he'll be out of office anyway, and you can't impeach a civilian.
Well,
the guy's plain old stupid.
Well, you know, Trump has been the best president, in my opinion. Trump has been the best president we've ever had.
In my lifetime.
And
I've seen 12. This is the best of my lifetime.
And, you know, I think we need to take advantage of that. And let's see. I remember Dwight David Eisenhower was the first president that I remember and that we studied and that we said the Pledge of Allegiance to and all that good stuff. And, you know, I tell you, Pedro, maybe I was young, but those were good times, even though we had a recession in...
Everybody loved America then, Charles.
Hey, man, we still love America. And let me say this. When you talk about things that presidents could be impeached for, how come they didn't impeach Lyndon Baines Johnson over the Tonkin Gulf incident? We know the Tonkin Gulf didn't happen.
Because Republicans suck.
No, because, I mean, if anything was an impeachable offense, what about that? What about, let's see, I'm making a note because I say these things on the air and then I forget them. Tonkin Golf. And then you have Clinton, who did all his stuff with Laurel and China and the campaign contributions and all that. No impeachment. And this man, he incites a riot. Give me a break. Did Barack Obama incite a riot when
Democrats
he said...
Democrats don't get impeached.
When he said...
Democrats don't go to prison.
When he said, Barack Obama said on the way out, resist, resist, resist. Do you remember that? Do you know I can't find that clip anywhere? I can't find that clip anywhere on the internet.
They scrub all that crap.
Yeah.
They scrub it off.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, man. Hey, look, man, it's we're running long here and really appreciate you calling in, dude. It's always a pleasure and privilege to have you call in, spend some time with us. Hey,
I enjoyed the conversation today. It was great. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, Frank always does a good job and you do, too. So appreciate you, man.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
And you too, Charles. You take care. I'll see you tomorrow.
All right,
take
bro.
Care, buddy.
All right. Bye bye. That was my friend out of Miami. Mr. Pedro, love him to death. Real American patriot. And see, you know, we're just talking about what's good for America. We don't care what color you are. We don't care what ethnicity you are. I mean, we're just talking about facts here. We are different. We are a racially mixed country. We're not like Japan. We're not like China. We're not homogeneous. And, you know, because Americans don't travel, they have no idea. Like, Americans think that all white people in Europe are white, and they're all, they have European, they have different cultures. You go to Portugal, you go to Spain, two entirely different countries, dude. You go down to South America, Peru, Colombia, Nicaragua in Latin America, all these kinds, there may be some Latino heritage, but they're all different. They have different ideas. They have different looks. They have different heritage. They have different makeup. It's amazing. I mean, when you look at the world that way, it's beautiful. And we all culminate here in America. We come together in America and we disagree to agree. We agree to disagree and we do what we have to do because that's who we are. I love it. And I love America and I love you all. And I'm going to end the show today on that note. And want you guys to know that we'll be back tomorrow. Same time, same place with the reality check. Charles Butler. Mm-mm.